do you hope will actually be brought into force with your bill?
Well, this is the first of a series of bills that I'll be introducing to try to put some ground rules around social media. This bill is focused on something that for many users may just appear to be a nuisance or annoyance, whereby you have agreements that you can't really understand, where you may have flashing arrows of trying to urge you to always agree, where you can never find the unsubscribe component on a on a particular site. But what experts have shown is there is actually a great deal of manipulative behavior, both to adults, and our bill also focuses on children. We think this is a good starting point. What we've decided to do is try to take a bit of a light touch and set up, in a sense, an industry-driven standard-setting body that would be quick enough and nimble enough to move, as you mentioned, towards the larger users, 100 million individual users a month as a break line. And then we'd have the FTC as the fallback regulator if that industry-driven standard, which, you know, from a financial standpoint is a little bit like a FINRA, would be the securities, this industry standard groups would be towards these dark patterns. And I think it's a good place to start. I've got a series of other ideas around privacy, identity, content, and around transparency, and there'll be more legislation coming in each of those areas.
Okay, we want to dig into those in a moment. But first, on this particular bill, it's bipartisan in nature. Do you think it'll get the sort of committees behind it that are needed to pass such a bill? Because at the moment, it doesn't seem to have that backing.
Well, this is an area that I think many of my colleagues, my background was in the technology field, so I hope I bring a little bit of knowledge to the floor. I actually believe all of the approaches that I'm going to take are bipartisan. I think they're less about liberal conservative and more about future past. And I think there is a growing recognition that kind of the wild, wild west days of the social media platform companies is coming to an end. And I actually think where a lot of the Commerce Committee, where this will be referred, and Deb Fisher, my partner on this, is a member of that committee, there is already work going on around the privacy domain, you know, following some of the European models. So what my hope is, as I add these other pillars, that they may be ultimately wrapped into a larger piece of legislation.
So let's talk about the privacy nature there, because that seems to be where more consensus is building. Would it be based upon, do you think, something like the general data protection rules, the GDPR rules that were brought into force in Europe?
I think there are members in both parties, again, working bipartisan on looking at GDPR. I think there are certain areas GDPR got right. There are certain areas that are a little bit clunky. But privacy alone is not going to, I think, address the issues we need to. I think there are issues around, for example, rights we ought to have, knowing when we're being contacted by a human being versus a bot, for example. Being able to put up a geolocator. If somebody says they're posting from New York, but they're posting from Moscow, at least having some indication that that is, may not be a true post in terms of where it originates. I think we ought to have a debate about identity validation. I worry, particularly as we think about how we grapple with hate speech, one way to look at this, and it would be have serious ramifications, would be having some level of identity validation. Estonia already does that as a price of entry onto their internet. There's a series of other ideas that we've got as well around transparency. I mean, one of the things we need to make sure, I think, for users to realize that these platforms are not free. If we knew how much data these companies were collecting about us and we knew that value of that data, I think there might be the ability for, frankly, new operators to come into the market as long as we also allow data portability.
Does it frustrate you how limited the U.S. has been in terms of getting any sort of legislation through? I'm looking at the EU having just made Facebook once again be more transparent about its terms and conditions to ensure that people do know that their data is being used. I think the U.K., in amidst Brexit turmoil, has managed to push through some issues about hate speech. When do you think the U.S. will be able to play catch-up? Will it be able to? Should it?
Caroline, I think that is a very good point. Most of the technology innovation and kind of rules of the road over the last 50 years have been set generally by the Americans. And I think we are defaulting that leadership, and not only to the Europeans on GDPR or to a much more bifurcated approach where California has taken some of the European models and trying to do that at the state level. I think, you know, America acting is frankly in the best interest of some of these tech companies as well, or they'll end up with a hodgepodge of rules and regulations all over. Just recently, Australia put in place extraordinarily challenging rules and regulations around content. So these are all issues that are going to be touched, and if our government can actually step up to the task, and I do think the good news is most of these issues do not fall on a partisan basis. Mm-hmm. So I think as long as we can get focused, there are a number of members that candidly don't understand fully how a lot of these platforms work. So there's been a bit of an education process as well going along.
And in some ways, the CEOs of the companies themselves have started to pick up the gauntlet. Zuckerberg himself, Mark Zuckerberg, CEO of Facebook, has been out there talking about regulating the company, talking about regulating privacy, harmful content, election integrity, data portability, and saying, look, we need a global consensus as well. Do you think the companies such as Google, Facebook, Twitter are now more amenable to regulation? And are you discussing this with them?
We are discussing it with senior level folks from Facebook today. They are saying the right words, but the devil's always in the details. I mean, I think a great sign would be their endorsement of our bill putting these kind of restraints on these dark patterns and manipulative processes. They said they'll take a look at that. I'd love to see them actually endorse this legislation as well as others, because I think they realize that the Wild West days are over, but whether they've really realized that some of their basic underlying business proposition in some of this may have to be re-examined.
How do you ensure regulation doesn't go too far?
I think that's always been the question, and that's one of the reasons why, for example, in this dark patterns, I'm not setting up the regulatory body to be a governmental entity. We're starting first with saying, can there be an industry-driven standards organization that would be more nimble, but there would be this government backstop with the FTC, and that has always been the rub. The point I'd push back is, if you have an Australian set of rules, a European set of rules, if you've got where India, where they're trying to do data localization, a different set of rules around data localization there, if you end up with this hodgepodge, these companies are not going to be able to provide kind of worldwide service. So I actually believe the value of having regulation come from the United States, hopefully with a light touch, will allow the innovation to take place, but also maybe set the standards on a global basis.
You're a senator with expertise in technology, which we love. You're also a senator who happens to sit on the Intelligence Committee, and I want to get your perspective here.
Sure.
Just slightly to the side, but we have to tackle the Mueller investigation. Your thoughts, please, right, on the confidence you have in the Attorney General and the role he is performing at the moment in terms of the Mueller investigation.
I have been very disappointed by the Attorney General. I mean, Mr. Barr has a great reputation as somebody who was an independent thinker, and unfortunately I've not seen that. I don't think he's approached the Mueller report in terms of, I'm anxious to see how much he's going to redact when we finally get a hold of that report. I'm reserving judgment. I supported the Mueller investigation and will accept its conclusions once I actually read the document. And then his testimony recently where he basically impugned the integrity of the FBI and the Department of Justice by saying he wanted to check whether there was spying going on. That sounded like a White House or right-wing talking point when he should know better. When the United States government discovered that Russia, through tools like social media, through tools like WikiLeaks, through tools like actually rattling our election security in over 20 states, if the FBI and Department of Justice had not started a counterintelligence investigation, they would have been extraordinarily negligent. And now, after the fact, trying to put in doubt some of that, when there's no question in terms of a uniform consensus from the intelligence community that Russia acted and acted, frankly, on behalf of Trump against Clinton, is pretty disingenuous of him.